Okay, it looks like participants have slowed down coming into the meeting. So this may be our group here today. It's a good looking group. I'm very delighted to welcome Jørgen Olesen today as our seminar speaker. Jørgen and I have never actually met, I don't believe. Although I read an obituary that he wrote several years ago when my good friend Torben Wolf died. And he mentioned that he was at a deep sea meeting in Southampton, England. Is that true?
That's were you correct. There? Yes, I was.
So you there. And I were in the, you and I have been in the same room for several days, I think. And
I guess so. Yeah.
Went on some old ships together and things, but we never actually introduced ourselves.
Okay.
So Jørgen comes to us from the what used to be the Zoological Museum in Copenhagen. It's now been renamed the Natural History Museum of Denmark. But it's a place that I've visited many times and knew most of the old timers, many of whom have passed away now. One of the really great places in the world to do zoology. I was always impressed by the fact that they had an entire museum, multi-story, really modern, beautiful building that was dedicated to nothing but zoology. And it was wonderful to wander up and down the halls of that institution and meet some of the truly great people in morphology and systematics and so on back in the day. And Jørgen is one of the people who's carrying on that tradition. Now I can hear our cockatoo yelling in the background. We're gonna have to ignore him for a minute. I'll get him taken care of shortly. Jørgen did his PhD at the University of Copenhagen and is a specialist on the biology of crustaceans. Very, very well-known crustacean biologist. And he did some work also, postdoctoral work at the Humboldt University in Berlin and also in Rostock in Germany, then came back as a lecturer at the University of Copenhagen for a number of years. And he's now a curator at the Natural History Museum of Denmark. One of the things that I really admire about Jørgen is that he is one of the three editors of this fantastic book. I have it here, Atlas of Crustacean Larvae, which is simply stunning. It's an absolutely beautiful book. I see it's on his shelf behind him as well.
Together with your book.
His book puts my book to shame. But anyway, Jørgen Olesen will lecture to us today about the phylogeny and the morphology and the systematics of crustaceans. This is a group that he knows very well. He's a person who doesn't just work on crabs and barnacles. This is a guy who knows all of the crustaceans, every little group, all of the brachiopods and the rhemopods and all of those things that we normally ignore as invertebrate zoologists. So Jørgen, I'll turn the time to you. It's very nice to have you here.
Thank you. So now I'll try to share my screen, see how that goes. So can you see my screen now?
Yes, that looks perfect.
And my voice is also clear. So as I said, Craig, if there's any problems with my voice and the sound, then just give me a hint. It's important that I don't speak into a black hole for an hour. So I'll give you this talk. And as Craig said, I'm the curator on this particular museum in Copenhagen, also a university professor. And who am I? Craig just introduced me. I like to spend as much time as possible in the field, like doing a pumping here. This is at the coastline of Spain, pumping for some Mayo fauna animals close to Valencia. So The background of me, actually in Copenhagen, as we also heard a little bit about, we have a, I would say, a pretty strong history and background. So in general, in marine biology, but certainly also in systematics and zoology in particular. And those traditions go very long back, going back to many expeditions that Denmark launched. Global expeditions like the famous, I would say, Galathea expeditions and the Dana expedition, but also many more. And we have a long chain of zoologists really on which shoulders we can each stand, including carcinologists. This is from the corridor down here in the Crustacean Library. This is all the guys that has been working on carcinology in this museum. I guess my picture, my photo will get on that wall one day, hopefully not too soon though. And and then I'm a curator, and all the stuff that was collected from these expeditions has basically made its way into our collection. So we have for the size of our country, I would say we have a large and quite impressive collection. And this is the book that I edited, as we heard about, and wrote a number of chapters in. So what will I do today? I'll take you through crustacea, take you on a walk through crustacean phylogeny. And of course, I'll mainly focus on my own work, but fortunately my work spans pretty broad, so I can choose examples from many different groups. I'll focus on larvae, especially the famous Nautilus larvae. Of course, you know that one, but you may not know exactly in how many forms and variations that type of larvae comes. And I'll pick a number of smaller, but phylogenetically important crustacean taxa and tell you about those, like the Y larvae. You may never have heard about Y larvae, but in an 40 minutes or so, you will know quite a bit about Y larvae. This is the guy, Hansen, one of my predecessors, going 100 years back, who actually discovered these Y larvae. And I will get through a number of collecting habitats also, like cave habitats and so on. Okay, so I work broadly on larvae and phylogeny and these things. I'm involved in high level crustacean, pan-crustacean phylogeny. I will use the most recent work to structure my talk. I'll not go through all the details here in this phylogeny, obviously, but this is just to show you a paper that came out recently. So this is right now state of the art paper for crustacean phylogeny. And when we say crustacean phylogeny nowadays, it also includes the hexapods, insects. We call them pan-crustacea now. This is basically the same phylogeny, but I just restructured it so it's nicer to look at. A lot of new things has happened. I'll not go through the details right now, but during the talk, I will focus on five major groups. Not all of the crustacean taxa, but this is enough for this talk, certainly. So when we get to number three or four or five, then you know that we are close to the end. That might be good to know. So the first group is a weird new grouping in crustacea called oligostraca. So that's like a collecting group in which it turns out that based on all these molecular data, that is transcriptomic data, a number of weird small crustacean groups got united. A group that has never been suggested based on morphology. So it's really a surprise group or a mystery group. I'll not say too much about them, but this one, for example, goes into this group. This is the Ostracoda, one of the groups that I'm not working on, so I'll skip it immediately. Another group that goes into this mystery taxon is the mist acrocarida. These tiny crustaceans, of which only something like 12 or 13 species are known worldwide, they were found originally from the American East Coast, described in 43 or something like that, and nobody knew exactly what it was. So a new higher level taxon, mist acrocarida, was set up. They live among sand grains. I hope you can see my video. They live among sand grains, so you can see they're pretty tiny and pretty unique. We also have them in Europe, quite a few species in the Mediterranean, a nice collecting site. I brought my friend here to do the hard work and dig the holes, because what you do is you dig a large hole and then you filter the ground or the marine groundwater that gets into that hole, and then you get them. I did my PhD on those, so I know them pretty well. This is one of the themes will be the Nauplius larvae of crustacea. So already here, this may break your ideas of what a Nauplius larvae is. These guys, they go through the development, just getting bigger and bigger, and then eventually they look like these strange guys here. And there's so much we do not know about these. They live, as I said, as myofauna interstitially among sand grains. One of the mysteries of the morphology are these furrows with teeth in each segment. Nobody knows what they're using these furrows for, amazingly. The third group that goes into this mystery group, oligostracea, are these guys, the branchiurans. They are parasitic on fish. They are known worldwide. We have one species in Denmark, argulus, attached here to the tail of a fish. They are pretty interesting. I had a PhD student working on these guys some years ago. So, also they do have a more or less like a Nauplius larvae. Then quite often looking at the development, we can spot something that makes them sort of familiar. So these have a kind of meta-Nauplius. And a common theme for crustacea and many other segmented animals are that they start their development having developed the most anterior appendages in crustacea. Those are the first antennae, the second antennae, and the mandibles. And that's also the case here. And when we go further in development, a lot of strange things do happen. They lose completely those swimming appendages. And instead, they transfer the mode of locomotion to these more posterior appendages. Also, they develop the suction discs. These animals are famous for having suction discs. They suck themselves, muscle facilitated to the skin of fish, so they can detach and attach exactly as they want. But they do not start out having these suction discs, as you can see here. They start out having some spines. They can still attach to the fish host, but during development, they grow the, in this particular case, the first maxillae, some mouth parts, gradually into these suction discs. And probably this also reflect what took place in evolution, because these crustaceans, they are pretty crazy to have these suction discs. They must have come from somewhere. Possibly, probably, they started out having maxillae just being hooks for attachment, and then it became or turned out to be more efficient to have these suction discs. Already number two, group number two, the barnacles. I have put it exclamation marks, because I'll not treat definitely all barnacles. Of course, you know what the barnacles are. They look like this, stalk barnacles and acorn barnacles and so on. I'll say nothing about the normal barnacles. I'll focus on a mysterious sister group to all the other barnacles, the so-called Y larvae. As I mentioned already earlier, they were discovered originally by this guy, one of my predecessors, Hansen. I have actually his the stick on which he put his hat every morning when he came. That's in my room. I don't have his hat, unfortunately. A very unusual researcher 100 years ago. He did a lot of work, and he discovered from plankton samples, dead plankton samples collected in the Atlantic, a couple of places, and also in the Bay of Kiel here in the Baltic, not too far away, a number of specimens, larval specimens, that could not be placed anywhere. He didn't know what they were. That was, of course, not unusual for that time. I mean, going back, there were plenty of larval types that nobody knew what was and what they corresponded to. But the big thing is that we haven't come much further since then. We just have these types of larvae, still known as Y larvae, because Hansen, he named them in his big monograph, he named them Y larvae. He also had X larvae and so on. Now they're known as Hansen's Y larvae. So at least in certain circles, certain crustacean circles, it's a fascinating, considered a fascinating mystery group. So a little has been known in the meantime. My former supervisor Jens Høeg and some of his people, they found got a little more information about the life cycle. So it's now established that they start out, these guys, as nauplii, then they metamorphosize into a cyprid. That's normally a attachment larval type, at least in other barnacles. For these guys, nobody has seen them attached to anything, so nobody knows. And then they found, when they treated the cyprids with some a hormone, they molted into a slug-like stage they called an ipsigon. And then they concluded, actually Hansen already had those ideas, they concluded that probably it's a parasitic animal for which the adults are not known. So that's, of course, a possibility. In a way, it's not a big mystery to have a few species that we do not understand the full life cycle of. But the big problem is that there are so many of these forms, unbelievably many, they are so common. This is what I'll be getting to right now. Of course, there are more people, especially from Japan, but also a very good American carcinologist, Mark Reiger, who has studied this group. So right now we have something like 13 species described. The problem is, it's a really confusing thing, and some of the species are described on the basis of the nauplius and some on the basis of the cyprid, so it's really confusing. So it has been rumored that in Japan, at Okinawa, a small island called Shizuku Island, there should be a spectacular diversity. That has been known and discovered by this guy I named before, Mark Reiger. And he has been staying at Shizuku for a month and been working on these things, but he had had so many difficulties really getting around how to treat the diversity, how to describe it, how to publish it. It turned out to be really a lot of work for him. So gradually he got more people involved, some Danes, which makes sense because Hansen was a Dane, so why not go to the Danes? So my former supervisor Jens Høeg got involved, I got involved. The thing is that from this pier right here, it's possible to collect an amazing diversity of these Y larvae, something that definitely, and I'll show you that later, belongs to a high number of forms or species. So the big mystery is, how come there are such common larvae, just so easy to catch, about which we do not really understand the life cycle? We do not know the adults for these animals, these larvae. We don't know their reproduction or anything. So that is the big mystery. We started out having a big grant. We promised, of course, to find the adult. We did not succeed. Half of what we promised was to cover and treat the diversity, and we are really on the way treating and describing the diversity, and this is really remarkable. This is some photos from our hard work at this field station. I think we have stayed there maybe 7 weeks in total, collecting and sorting and photographing and stuff. So it's really a demanding work. The thing is, when you have such a big variation of something, you have to treat each individual at the individual level, because there's no way easily to group these things. We got over the span I mentioned, the collecting span, something like 10,000 larvae, and the variation is simply amazing. And we'll get to that. This is some of the variation. These are all equivalent stages across different forms. They cannot be fitted into the same life cycle, because that would be another option. When you have a diversity of something, you don't know what it is. Maybe they belong to the same, or at least some of them, to the same life cycle. But this is not possible, because we know at least a bit of the life cycle, so we can culture them partly in small petri dishes. So all the larvae we see here, they are all last stage nauplius with a cypriot inside. You can recognize the cypriot because there are two big compound eyes, and then there's a nauplius eye in the middle. So these are equivalent stages, and so they cannot be fitted into the same life cycle. That's for sure. And they come, as you can see here on the videos, if they are working, they come in different forms. These three, for example, that we call the bumblebee because of the coloration, come as an early nauplius looking like this. This is the last stage nauplius with a cypriot inside, and this is the cypriot. And this is a sausage shaped form. We call it, we have a nickname for that one, the yellow sausage. So it's also at the cypriot level that there are many variations. So the question is how to deal with this. We need to get that out to get it published. That's important. So one way is to pick them and describe them one by one as simply species descriptions. This is one way we are working on that also. But we also attack it from a molecular perspective, because obviously we have been a little bit concerned, what are we dealing with? And virtually no molecular data was available for these very common larvae. So we have started out as a PhD student, Niklas Dreyer, who is working hard on this. So this is the first primitive phylogeny based on 34 specimens, and on just a fraction of the 18S molecule. And to our big relief, we could group them in a meaningful way, or this fraction of the molecule could group these larvae in a meaningful way. Deliberately, we chose some that we knew were exactly similar. So that's a good test of the molecular approach, the primer selection, and whatever gene you are selecting, it's a good check that actually what you know is similar morphologically, also group the same, and that's certainly the case. So we can say already now, even though this work is absolutely not finished, that just based on this method, it seems like on this plate alone, there'll be something like 13 different species. So as I mentioned, we are describing them one by one also, and I hope I have a life that is long enough for describing all these, because there might be 30 or 40 species, and how to do that. There are no shortcuts when it comes to taxonomy, and despite they are small, these animals, they are so complicated. So this is just examples of plates from one of the descriptions of the one we call the yellow sausage. So really a lot of work goes into this, but I think it's necessary. So this one is getting a name. This is a very distinct one. We found it both at Okinawa and also in Taiwan at the moment, but probably it's more widespread. And probably these guys, they are, I forgot to say that, they are actually widespread. They seem to be quite common in Southeast Asia, certain places, but they're also at the Bahamas, for example, the Canary Islands, and as I mentioned, the Baltic and in the Norwegian fjords. But nowhere has they been found in such high abundance as in Japan. Okay, let's jump to a group that is more well known by you, the Malacostraca. This is by far the most diverse group of the crustacea, and this is where all the well-known forms belong to, like the decapods, lobsters and spiny lobsters and shrimps and crabs and so on, and also euphorciations, and also all the pericarids, the isopods, the amphipods, and the cumaceans, the stomatopods. So a lot of well-known groups of crustacea, but there are much more, and I like to always focus on the forms and the taxa that are in between all the more well-known ones. I'm working on Malacostracans of this type, different groups, so they are not really looking like typical Malacostracans. They are a bit remote from shrimps and lobsters and so on. So all these look sort of the same, but they're not closely related. They should probably be fitted at different places within the Malacostraca. And common to all of them are that they live in caves or groundwater. This guy, for example, Mitsukaris is from Bermuda. This guy, Anaspides, is from New Zealand. This Thermus bonacea is from an Italian cave. And the Stygiomycetes, this particular one, is from the Turks and Caicos, also from a cave environment. So I'll just pick one of these, and I'll not tell you about all of them. I'll pick the speleogryphacea. They are fascinating. So they were first described, I think, in the 30s or something like that, from South Africa, from the so-called bat cave in the Table Mountain. Since then, two species has been described from Australia and one from from South America, so it's a real Gondwanaland distribution. So I had the luck of getting in touch, because these taxa, they're not easy to obtain or to collect or get, because they are so rare, and you need to be familiar with exactly where to get them and get into a cave and so on. I got in touch with a woman working, a biologist from Brazil, that I came across on Facebook, funnily enough, and she was working on this group, so I got myself invited to go to Brazil, and she set up a nice collecting trip. It's Livia in the middle, who's smiling to us right now, who I hope the video is running in your case. I hope so. So she could set up a nice collecting trip for me to that cave. I'm walking around there. Then actually, these are not so difficult to collect when you get all the permits and you find that this is a touristic cave, so you can get in there. But you need, of course, permits, export permits, and all these things to work with these animals. But when you get these, it's not so difficult. So I went there and collected, brought my my high-speed equipment. It looks very primitive as it is right now here on the hotel table of the hotel room, but it has provided, as you can see, I hope the videos are working in your case, nice videos of the animals moving around. And these are the first observations of feeding speleogryphacians at all, and swimming speleogryphacians. So that was the fun part, to do the collecting. Now the hard part remains, that is to get it together as a paper. It will require a little bit of work. Malacostracans, I'm interested always in developmental strategies, larval development and morphology and so on. And it turns out that Malacostracans are by far the most complicated group when it comes to developmental strategies. So it's not so easy to get an overview. Just to mention some strategies, we have, of course, the perichaerids that are brooding, the embryos on the ventral side, on the stomach. We have, that's, for example, mycets, as you see here, it's also amphipods. Then we have one guy here, Thermospinacea, also considered a perichaerid, that do it completely opposite. They brood the youngsters on their backs, so under the carapace, or under the shield, like a small, almost like an aquarium here. It's transparent in this photo. You can see the embryos are lying in here. And of course, brooding is really a common thing in Malacosticans. You also have all the crabs and the lobsters, the spiny lobsters, and certain shrimps, Caridian shrimps. They all brood the embryos under the tail. Some, of course, release larvae, like this very common type of larvae, crab larvae, suia larvae. Stomatopods also have spectacular free-living larvae. And to make it even more complicated, we have two groups within Malacosticans that I am particularly interested in because they have a very complicated type of development. Surely you know the krill, the euphorciations, and also the pinnate shrimps or the dendrobranchiate shrimps. These are decapods. But common for these two are that they have free-living nauplii, you know, this typical crustacean larval type. So those are the only Malacosticans for which this is the case. And then if we use the pinnate shrimp over here as an example, they go through a cycle of normally six nauplii, and then they shift into some type of intermediate larvae called protozoea, and some mysis stages that are more like juveniles. And basically it's the same thing for euphorciations, but with some difference, and the larvae has different names. So the big debate, at least in certain circles, has been whether these nauplii within Malacosticans, nauplii are so common outside Malacosticans, but what about these guys inside Malacosticans? Are they ancestral? So did the original Malacostican, I have a phylogeny here from another transcriptome phylogeny that I'm working on for Malacosticans. So did the ancestral Malacostican, did they actually go through the development starting with a nauplius larvae, or did the nauplius larvae reappear for these two taxa that I just mentioned, the euphorciations and the dendrobranchiate shrimps? So this has been sort of a debate. So when we map or construct the so-called ancestral state on this phylogeny, is pretty complicated, then at least with this coding, the trick is always the coding, how you code these things. But here we have coded different types of development, and the color coding is over here. And for example, the yellow one, that's the ventral brooding, the marsupium that you see in all the perichaerids, the amphipods and the isopods. So that's one, so certainly that's a yellow one. Another type is brooding on the pleopods as crabs and lobsters. And then there are these two taxa that do have free-living larvae. And when we run the analysis with this scoring, then it turns out that probably, or at least there's a 50% chance that the ancestral Malacostican went through a nauplius phase, which in my view makes a lot of sense. Okay, group number four, the branchiopods, another, well, not weird, but maybe unusual group of crustaceans. Not so many people are working on branchiopods. So what are they? They are made up of fairy shrimps, like these guys, tadpole shrimps, and clam shrimps, and then of course the water fishes. Something like 1,000 species are described. Most of them are water fishes. So maybe you can hear the sound here. This is from the deer garden just north of Copenhagen, because many of these, except the water fishes, they live in temporary pools. Like this one, a threatened habitat, at least in the very cultivated Denmark. But here we have habitats of this type. We have very few species of fairy shrimps in Denmark, but this is a good place to go during the spring and collect these animals. So common for them are that most of them, at least the fairy shrimps and the tadpole shrimps and the clam shrimps, they live in these temporary pools using resting eggs. So one of them I will use here to exemplify a very important a trend in crustacean development. I mentioned it already. It's very typical that we start with a nauplius having the nauplia appendages that they use for swimming. And these are amazing because they go through maybe 30 stages, some of the species do at least, and they only change gradually from stage to stage. So something like for each molt, they might add just one limb and another limb and another limb, or even not a complete limb. So it takes something like 30 molts before they get completely adult. And there's no abrupt change, like a metamorphosis or something that is so common in many other crustaceans, an abrupt shift in morphology from one phase to another. Here they just go step by step by step, and probably this is ancestral for crustacea. So these are like living fossils, these anostracans. But in this deer park, there's also another brachiopod, the clam shrimps that I've been working on. It's so nice just to be able to go 10 kilometers north of Copenhagen and then find this beautiful pond in which there are these animals. And I think I have something like 5 publications based on stuff that are collected in this pond. So this is one of them done with an earlier student here, Sandra Siegert, who and we studied this particular limb the males use for mating with the females. So it's very common when you have the animals that are bivalve, and then during mating the male have to attach to the female, and very often it takes place at the edge or the margin of the female's carapace. This is also what happens here. So I think my videos is not running as good on your computer as they do on mine, so but hopefully okay. So we did a lot of work, or she did a lot of work on that, and it was amazing. I mean, people knew that these animals were mating this way, but nobody studied that in detail. So we got the idea simply to use close-up videos and zoom in and see what they are doing. And it turned out to be a beautiful study. In the same pond, the same animals have remarkable larvae, maybe among the most remarkable crustacean larvae at all. These UFO-shaped larvae that go through this development like this, they just get bigger and bigger, and then suddenly they metamorphosize into these bivalved clam shrimps. And certainly they are not very elegant swimmers, but if we remove, this is a big labrum, you know, crustaceans and insects, they have this labrum that covers all the feeding appendages. If that is removed, then basically what we see under that labrum are normal nauplia appendages. So they are just strange from the surface, but underneath they look more normal. Okay, so most of the brachiopods, they are filtrators, like the fairy shrimps, tadpole shrimps, maybe not completely filtrators, certainly clam shrimps are normally, And waterfalls like this Daphnia are well known to be amazing filtrators. But there are a couple of groups, this is one of them, representing one of them, that are predatory or raptorial. And I'm interested in those, and I'll speak a little bit about those because I have some spectacular video recordings of how they are feeding that are showing for the first time how this takes place. Certainly, it's easy to spot that these water flies are not standard water flies. There's nothing filtratory about these limbs. So these are really robust spinose limbs that obviously can be used for grabbing whatever they grab, whatever food items they need. And but actually, this is like a black box. There are studies around studying the feeding, but it's more like clearance setups and so on. But nobody has really studied how they are handling prey and attacking prey, probably because it is pretty difficult. You have to wait. It may be a little bit like a lion on the savannah. They only feed once in a while, so you have to be ready with your camera exactly when they do that. That's not like a filtrating animal. You can just set up your camera and then you can see what it is doing, because it's doing the same all the time. This particular group of raptorial cladoceans are pretty interesting, actually, not only from a feeding point of view, but also because they have a amazing distribution. And there are something like 30 species, and maybe you can get that these have spectacular morphologies. The more common one is a freshwater form, that one called Polyphemus. That's the one you saw earlier. That's I can go and collect that in a pond just 200 meters away. It's very common in Europe. And then, of course, there are marine forms, and many of you will have seen these forms, species of Podon, Evatna, and Pleopis. But then there has been an amazing variation in the Ponto-Caspian region some million years ago. They must have gotten caught in that region, and then radiation started. So there are something like 20-something endemic species only in the Caspian Sea, the Aral Lake. Unfortunately, now the Aral Lake is more or less gone, but until that, it also had an amazing diversity. But the Caspian Sea still have such a diversity. And the forms look amazing, like this one, Cercopagus, with an extremely long tail. This is also an invasive species. Many of these species are invasive, probably because they are adapted to brackish water in that region. So they find their way to the Baltic, for example. So this one is also common certain places in the Baltic Sea, unfortunately not in Denmark, but further up north. It has went as far as to the Great Lakes in US, by the way. So I'm interested in that, and not only for the feeding, but for collecting material for a molecular work that is upcoming. So I brought a student of mine to Russia not a long time ago to do some collecting. We were not extremely successful, but still we managed to do enough work for his master thesis. And hopefully these will start to run also on your computer. So they swim. One thing is they swim in a very unique way compared to other water flies. So they are like hummingbirds. They can, now this is slowed down, of course, the video at the lower corner here. But they're extremely fast and they can turn around and so on. So probably clearly adapted to really searching food. And we have some information from the videos, the high-speed videos. It's running in a circle up here in the upper left corner. And Aske got quite a few of these wonderful video shots here. And this is one where it is grabbing a smaller cladoceran. So it turns out, so we have information for a variety of species. It turns out that they they grasp a number of different things, and it depends probably on the species. This one is, as I said, grasping a smaller species of water flea. And what they're all doing, they are waiting a little bit. They are approaching the prey or the item, and then they are waiting probably to adjust the distance it has to jump. So because these are, it seems, visual hunters, which is, if not unique, then very unusual. And this is something you want to study further. Okay, now I'll go for the last group, the Ramipedia. I don't know whether you have heard about these. So they are not, it's not an old group in the system of crustacea. They got discovered as late as in the 1980s. So it's not too long time ago. The thing is that they are adapted for some remote habitats, caves, so-called anchialine caves. So they are not easy to get. It requires cave diving, and for collecting, one brings typically down maybe some falcon tubes or bottles, and then collect them to get them up alive. Collect them one by one, simply. So as I mentioned, they were discovered in the 80s by an American by the name of Jill Yeager. So this is the habitat type you see here. So they live really in a remote place, not in the sea and not in the fresh water. This is cross section of something like Yucatan, where you have limestone and forming small freshwater lakes called cenotes. And then one have to dive down here into the freshwater lake and down into to these tunnels and catch these animals. So they can be pretty common certain places, but only places like, almost only places like this. There are actually a few cases. I have even collected one myself at the Turks and Caicos. So in a cave where I was just walking, so in some small cave ponds, no diving was needed. I just got it with my net. So that is possible. And they had a, well, you could say a worldwide distribution, but that may be a little bit an over-exaggeration, because most of the diversity are from the Caribbean, mostly from the Bahamas, but also, as we can see down here, from the Dominican Republic, Yucatan, Cuba, and Turks and Caicos, as I mentioned. But then also two species are found at the Canary Islands and one in Western Australia. And obviously, since it's animals that are not easy to collect, a lot remains to be done on these animals. And I've had the luck to link to yet another American by the name of Tom Iliff. He must be on one of these shots. I guess it's him diving here, who has specialized in collecting cave fauna at Bermuda and Bahamas and other places. I've been on a number of expeditions, and we are supervising right now a PhD student on the diversity of the ramipedes. Let's show you how they look like in a slowed down high speed video here. This is a very special form. If it shows up again, you'll see that some of the mouth parts are really amazingly large, really specialized. I'll get back to that in just a moment. You can see it's passing right now. Nobody knows what they are using these specialized mouth parts for. They contain heavy musculature, so well, they must be used for something. All of them are presumed to be predators, so obviously that plays a role for the function of these mouth parts. So we had another great expedition just, was it last year, to Turks and Caicos, where we really got a lot of collecting done. We had our lab set up in this nice house, and we were able to work on these animals. It's very important to photograph everything alive, to simply get the best quality images and so on. But it's hard work, but it's possible, and you can get images like this. This is the five species known from Turks and Caicos. And among these are one new species that we are working on describing, and possibly we have another one also. So we are finding new species when we get out and do these samplings, and molecular work is really adding a lot to that because there's cryptic speciation involved here. So molecular data is important. A little bit about the mouth parts. There's one cave at Abaco in Bahamas where eight species are living sympatric, which is really amazing. This is some of them. And you can see they are really different. This is the one that had the other one that had these very specialized mouth parts used for whatever, crushing something. But they all have specialized predatory mouth parts just in different ways. And some are small, some are large, and some of them may even be preying on some of the others. So, but nobody knows anything about that because it's extremely difficult to study. But then they are the only crustaceans known to have poison glands. They have that actually exactly in these very specialized enlarged pairs of mouth parts. There's also a poison gland with an exit at the tip. So some years ago, the larvae was found. I remember as PhD student, I was speaking with people about this. It would be so wonderful to have the larvae for these remipedes, because the idea was that maybe the larvae can tell where they should be placed in the phylogenetic system, because that is sometimes what larvae can be used for, because they may have more conserved features. And then suddenly, 16 specimens were collected from a specific cave at Abaco, Dan's cave, only 16 specimens. And that's the only specimens ever collected of larvae of remipedes. So now at least we know a little bit. We know that they start with the nauplius type, as you can see. And we know that they probably do have a gradual development typical for, let's call it primitive crustaceans. We know that they are non-feeding, maybe practical in the caves, not to rely on external food items, so they are less teutrophic. But the thing is, their morphology is so probably modified, no feeding appendages, no structures to look at, that they did not contribute very much to placing them inside the system. They're just strange larvae in a way. So, and even more strange, remipedes started out being suggested as a sister group to the rest of the crustacea, being primitive. That was the first idea, probably because of the elongate shape and the many segments. This is typically something people consider primitive. So, but they have really been on it. So they were placed here at the base of the crustacean system. But then when the big molecular data sets started to come out, including the ones that I'm involved in, they moved up to a very strange position as sister group to the insects or the hexapods. So that's really a long trip. And that's not, you couldn't call that a primitive position. So, but what sense does it make? And that's not easy to understand for sure. But when one start to look at the details, sometimes when you know that a certain phylogeny is as extremely large molecular data sets are suggesting, then you start looking into the details and maybe suddenly some kind of morphological similarities will turn up. It's not always the case. In this case, however, looking into the mouth of these remipedes, as I like to do, then actually when you start analyzing the structure of the mouth parts and how they exactly look like and how many parts they are composed of, then it turns out that there is not a long gap between the detailed morphology of the mouth parts of these remipedes that live in caves and then certain insects or hexapods like this archaeognath. It's a terrestrial wingless insect, considered a primitive insect. And I'll not take you through all the details, but when one starts to look at the mouthparts, then it actually does make some sense. But the scenario, the evolutionary scenario that we have to accept for the origin of hexapods is not easy to grasp. Does, for example, the fact that these two taxa might be sister groups, does that mean that the ancestral insect has gone through a cave phase? That's one possibility. Probably not. Probably it's more simple to assume that both of them simply have common ancestors in the marine somehow, maybe with fresh water as a stepping stone, maybe a little bit like the brachiopods, the fairy shrimps, as you saw, and then they have diverged into different directions, going fully on land, becoming terrestrial, and then going into these caves. But basically, we lack so much information. We lack really fossils, I would say, to understand the details of the transition from marine crustaceans to terrestrial insects. It's a black box at the moment. So how to summarize when I did that, tried to do that a few hours ago, I thought, well, it's not easy to summarize all what I just said, but here at least we have the phylogeny that probably is close to what will really be the final one in a couple of years, having this group, strange group, this mystery group, the oligostracan composed of the mystacocaryids, brachyurans on parasitic on fish, the ostracods, mussel shrimps, and actually also pentastomids, some vertebrate parasites, I didn't mention those, being sister group to the rest that is composed of the malacosticans, the lobsters, and all the ones that we all know, together with the barnacles. That's also a strange group, actually, having the barnacles and the malacosticans together. There's really no similarities here. And then another group seems to be showing up again and again, and that's the one with insects and remipedes, as I just mentioned, but they group with brachiopods and also with a weird small primitive fall called cephalocarida. And then right now the copepods seems to be the problem in the big data set that we analyzed a couple of years ago. They were jumping a little bit around as copepods do. So they are sometimes in this group together with actually close to the barnacles. Sometimes they jump into this other group with the hexapods. So that's really not settled at the moment. But certainly we can conclude that crustacean phylogeny has been revolutionized the last 10 to 15 years. There are few of the classical big higher level taxa left, like something that was called the maxillopoda. But at least the classical key taxa still remains. By that I mean the malacosticans, that's still a good group, so that's okay. The brachiopods, or the freshwater guys, still a good group. And also the barnacle group is still a good group. But it's more the relation between these higher level taxa that is that has been changed a lot. And then, of course, we have the hexapods inside crustacea, which is really something that nobody dreamt about until maybe 15 years ago. And then the thing I said before is really difficult to find something morphological supporting many of these higher level clades, except maybe for the mouthparts, for the remipedes and the hexapods. There are nothing for that clade, and for the other clades, it's virtually impossible. And maybe this is because the clades or the group as such is simply too old, so a lot has happened in the evolution of this group. So by that, I would like to thank you all for your attention, and I will be happy to answer whatever question you can come up with.
Thank you very much, Jørgen. I'll ask everybody to turn their videos back on if they feel so inclined. And once we do that, we would very much like to give you a round of applause.
Thank you.
Nice talk.
Thank you. A little bit strange to sit here in my office completely alone, and it's evening here, but it was a pleasure.
Does anyone have questions? Looks like Svetlana.
Yeah,
Svetlana, do you have a question?
Yeah, I have several questions. So one, I guess, is you mentioned thermospinations and how they brood underneath the carapax on the dorsal side. Mm-hmm. And so that is that similar to how cladocerans brood?
You can say it. It's similar. I mean, they use also the cavity under their carapace. So, but there are a number of crustaceans that do that. So we have the thermospinations, and that's really strange. That's the only group inside Malacostrica. So that they are like really strange. What do they do there? But then we have cladocerans, of course. But those are not the only ones in that group. There's also a clam shrimp that is doing it. Maybe we know that actually the ancestor to the cladocerans are doing it. But there are also ostracods. So it's a relatively common thing. But there's no evolutionary connection between these groups. Certainly, those habits are independent in evolution. So, yeah, it's something different crustacea has decided to do at different times. But the thermospinacea, that's really a mystery group, because how did that come about inside the Malacosticans? So sometimes, we don't know that for sure yet. Sometimes thermospinations are grouped together with the pericarida. Those are the ones that are brooding ventrally in a brood pouch, eventually amphipods and isopods. Sometimes they're even, traditionally, they're grouped inside pericarids. So that's crazy, I think, to imagine that you have first, you decide to place your embryos ventrally, and then suddenly you change during evolution and place them dorsally. So something is wrong in that scenario for sure. So I think also the new phylogeny we are working on will come up with a more simple solution for that.
My other question is, I've heard, and I don't know if it's true, that some remipedes are venomous. Is that true?
Mm-hmm. And we think they are all venomous. But it has not been studied for all of them, of course, but at least for a couple of species. I mean, the poison gland, the venom gland, I should say, have been described and studied. That was a new big thing maybe 6-7 years ago. There was a paper out on that. So that's the paper that established, I think I said poisonous, I meant venomous. Those are different words. Only one word in Danish for those two different things, so that's why I'm confused. But that's the only case within crustacea of venomous.
Is the venom similar to the venom of some insects?
That's a good question, because if they're sister group to the insects, I don't know, but I know that there are other people interested in that, so there might be people around who knows the details about that. I don't know.
And what do they eat? And do you think they use the venom to subdue their prey?
I guess they do, but nobody has observed that. These animals are so hard to study. And we get them up alive, so we can keep them in small aquaria for a while or petri dishes, but it's so difficult to get them to behave in a natural way. But actually it has been observed at least once by a guy from Holland or the Netherlands who worked on these remipedes a few years ago. He managed to bring back some specimens from the Yucatan to the Netherlands, and he set up a small aquarium, and he had a camera observing them, surveying them for days. And he had one observation on one specimen attacking an artemia. He was feeding them with artemia. So I have actually his video showing how they, in a nasty way, grasps such an artemia, and then they curl the entire body in a very nasty way around the specimen. And then there has been some cave divers who has observed specimens, remipede specimens, swimming around in the caves with the shrimps in their mouth parts. But it's information of that type we have and to piece whatever we believe together based on. So it's not so easy.
I think Richard has
one more question.
Richard had a question, then I think Ernie did.
Yeah, thanks, Jørgen. I just wanted to tell you that we found at least two phacetotectins here in Oregon. They're not common. Another one from Friday Harbor and two from the Caribbean of Panama.
I'm very interested in hearing that. Actually, I had in mind to ask you
how common. Yeah. We've sequenced them with CO1, but we haven't done anything else.
Because there are a little bit of information in GenBank, very, very little.
Yeah.
So what you have done is not published.
No, it's not. In fact, I knew that Mark was working on this. I didn't know you were part of the team, but
you know Mark Ryan.
We postdoced at the same time in the Smithsonian back in the Pleistocene. So anyway, I just wanted to point out, and I'll correspond with you, but it's really exciting to hear the work that you guys are doing with the fantastic diversity. Thank you.
Yeah, but I would be happy to. I mean, I think we established now this wild larvae business for quite a few years. I hope so. And I mean, I may have quite a few years left to do more work. So I would like to expand to other areas of the work of the world eventually. So that's important.
Great. I was really pleased to find them here since they hadn't been reported, and I knew that you'd be interested. So thank you. Yeah.
Ernie.
Yes. So first, thank you for such a fine lecture. And I must say, I'll bet everybody online today envies you for your life of adventure and discovery. Every day, a new thing. I think that's just terrific. Hmm. Well, I have one or two questions. And one is, when Craig Venter went around the world on his yacht and sampled seawater, he reported having 10,000 different viruses per cubic meter of seawater. And of course, there's a microbial world of bacteria too. So my question is, how do invertebrates resist all these potential infections by both bacteria and viruses? Or don't they?
Yeah, I mean, I cannot answer that, but I can say that when we try to keep, I mean, I've kept dozens, hundreds of different types of larvae in small petri dishes. And I can tell you, if you don't keep them in the right way, if you do nothing, then they get attacked immediately. Maybe because they are not moved around by currents and stuff like that the right way. So maybe just the basic fact of being moved around by water in a natural habitat is important. Certainly, it's a nuisance in petri dishes. For instance, the wild larvae that you're speaking about, they, after a while, so most of them actually go through their entire development to a separate within 4 to 10 days, and that's okay. You can get animals to do that without doing too much of an effort. But if they have to develop more than that, then you really have to do something special to stir them around or whatever. Otherwise, you kill them, which you don't like. So that was not an answer, unfortunately.
Oh, but that's good. There's an unsolved question, a problem to look at. I will never walk on a beach again without thinking about what I'm walking on. And I thank you for that. The first thing I'm going to do when I get back to Oregon is dig a hole at sunset and get the water, probably centrifuge it, get a pellet to see what's there. And so for these little bitty organisms, I was surprised at how small they are, these Henson Y forms. So you had a 10 micron scale there next to them. Yeah. A red cell is 8 microns in diameter. So this is a very small creature.
Yeah. Okay, so they're not.
Yeah, has anybody ever given any idea to culturing these for genetic studies? So we have fruit flies, we have C. elegans, of course, a host of bacteria. Is there anything, zebrafish, is there anything that would recommend culturing these for genetic studies?
if you speak specifically about the Y larvae for which the adults are not known, then it would be wonderful if it would be possible to culture them, because that would be the same as having solved the question what the adults are and their life cycle. The problem is this is not possible. We have tried, not so much on the expeditions I've been on, but earlier, my earlier supervisor, Jens Høeg and Henrik Glenner and these guys, they really tried to culture them, but it's not easy. After a while, they simply die. So it would be wonderful to be able to culture them, but it's not possible. But at least we can keep them alive, so we get enough information for doing the diversity work and the taxonomy work that we think is important, because it's amazing that you have a diversity of something that is so common and we don't know what it is. So we think it's important to put that on the map for people. So at least we can do that. And speaking about molecular data, we do use some molecular data for these guys. But and we also have some type of transcriptomic data for some samples. But really what we want to do is like basic taxonomy and phylogeny. So we don't need much more than a few genes. It's simply overkill to do like full genomic work. But it's for somebody to do for sure. Mm-hmm.
Before we move on to another question, Ernie opened the door for a shameless advertisement, which is that next week's seminar speaker is Roberto Danovero, who's one of the top authorities in the world on marine viruses. And he's an award-winning speaker, president of the zoological station in Naples. So if you want to hear about viruses, come next week. Svetlana, you have another question, I think.
Yeah, I have several more questions, but I don't know if I have the opportunity to ask all of them. One is sort of biogeographical. It looks like the known distribution of ramipedes is very disjunct, right? There's a bunch of species in the Caribbean, and then there is like one in Africa or something, and one in Australia. I can't remember exactly. But how do you explain this disjunct distribution? Is it just that people haven't looked elsewhere because they're so hard to study because you have to cave dive, or are they relics, or what are your thoughts on the matter?
Yeah, I mean, this is when I meet up with the colleagues in that business, the cave divers and Tom Eilif and these guys, this is what we are speaking about very often. So in May, yeah, the question is it a true distribution as you suggest, or is it something that reflects collecting? And we don't know for sure. Obviously, the Caribbean is close to people who likes to cave dive. It's close to US and so on. So there's been a lot of activity going in that direction. But I think I can say for a fact that there are not required for these types of crustaceans and also a number of other ancheoline animals, different thermospinations as we spoke about, and groups of ostracots. For them to be present is required a certain type of caves of a certain size and so on. And these are not so common other places than in the Caribbean. So it may be linked to the type of habitat you have, especially in the Bahamas for some reason. They're very common in the Bahamas. So they may, I mean, I believe that there might be more species different places, but I wouldn't expect as many as in the Caribbean. But on the other hand, who has been doing cave diving along the, let's say, the East African coast and places like that? So it would be nice to go there. Mm-hmm. So it's something to study. And also the question is, are these habitats related or connected, or is it just reflecting ancient distribution? That's another question.
We've had the questions dominated by faculty so far. Do any students have questions that they would like to ask? Well, if not, then Svetlana has several more, I think.
But that's my other question is also biogeographical in nature. So you mentioned this unprecedented diversity of Passera tachara larvae in Japan and Okinawa. Mm. How do you explain that? And does it give you any hints about what the adults may be parasitizing?
Mm. That's a question right to the core. So, yeah, I mean, not many people are doing exactly what we are doing. I mean, spending so much time. I had my assistant here coming with me and doing plankton sampling every day for a long period from that pier. So it's a lot of effort that goes into collecting. So of course that means something. Maybe people other places don't do it that way. But on the other hand, I mean, we are certainly not the first people who are just sorting basic plankton samples in the world. I mean, marine biologists have been doing that for ages. So if there were many places where you just from a pier, 2 meters of water could collect a similar variation or diversity, I mean, I think we would know that. So my feeling is that something special is going on in Southeast Asia. But I mean, it cannot be the only place. There was another guy, Ito, a Japanese, who did his work before Mark Reiger came out there and did his work. And he also found a huge diversity. That was another place in Japan, but not as diverse as they seem to be at Okinawa. And we have been doing work in Taiwan also, and they are not as diverse, but they are around. But it's not like only 2 specimens, as we just heard about from your place. It's Taiwan. It's still like dozens of specimens after some work. So they are around, but maybe not as common as they are in these places that we have been investigating. And they're also in the deep sea and many, many different places. But we have collected over those 2 periods of the field work. I think I mentioned that 10,000 larvae, simply collected them and sorted them. That's a lot. Then another study, the next most abundant discovery is something like 300 specimens. So there's really a gap between 10,000 specimens to 300 or 400 specimens from the White Sea by some Russians. So maybe something unique is going on. And what does that tell us about the host? That's a good question. So that was the initial idea to go. We have the idea that it's most likely a parasitic form. That will also explain why the adult has not been discovered. I mean, some tiny adult hiding as a parasite on something. But it's not so easy. We have had many ideas for how to make culture setups of the potential host specimens and so on. But even in that little bay we are collecting our larvae, there are hundreds of potential hosts. It may also be fishes, who know? It may be copepods, who knows? It's really a black box, completely unknown, and a big mystery. Somebody has to solve it.
Jørgen, is there any possibility that ramipedes actually evolved from insects instead of the other way around?
They would have lost all, for example, all the larval stages and reinvented even a crustacean nauplius and so on. So maybe that's too complicated. But I mean, that's just a gut feeling. I would think that ramipedes have gone crazy in an evolutionary direction. I think, yeah.
Could I ask? A question, and in fact, Craig, for you and all your faculty too, I was very impressed by your scanning electron micrographs. Boy, were those beautiful, and also illustrative of these life forms. As someone who doesn't regularly read your literature, is there now a compendium of scanning electron micrographs of invertebrates, or is it scattered throughout the literature? Has anybody made an atlas?
Scattered. But actually, for example, the Atlas of Crustacean Larvae that I wrote, maybe 20 chapters in that book, the book we mentioned a couple of times, I based most of my chapters on scanning electron micrographs, because I've been doing that for many, many years. It was actually the first tool that I learned as a student, and I was so amazed the kind of information you could... Yeah, that's one example. I was so amazed the kind of information you could get out. I just wanted to find a way to work so I could have an excuse to just generate hundreds or thousands of photos. And then I have many of my research projects, at least in the beginning, they were in a way phrased so that I could find an excuse to go into the SEM room.
Yes. Well, here's another
career
path.
But I don't think, yeah, but...
Here's another career path for one of the students.
Yeah. So we are lucky here in Copenhagen because I'm actually the one responsible right now for that lab. But it has always been very easy for us to go there. We have a setup where we are not paying specifically for the hours we are using it. So that's really an advantage, because what I'm doing takes really a long time, because that's one of the tricks, that is to spend a lot of time and take a lot of photos. And if you have to pay by hour, then you will not get as many results. So that's very important to have it as a standard tool. And then in the beginning, there are actually a guide early on published by Bruce Felkenhauer, yet another American, maybe some of the faculties know him, but he published a guide into how to do SEM in the best possible ways. I used that in the beginning, but now I have my own tricks, of course. And you are not the first one who are asking how to get such nice results. And there are actually not many tricks. One of the tricks is to have a lot of material and then choose the best ones. That's one trick. And skip all the bad ones.
Okay, last call. Do we have any students who would like to ask a question? This is a remarkable opportunity to talk to a famous man from Copenhagen. Nobody wants to take us up on it. Oh, Svetlana, this is the last question then.
Yeah, okay. Well, the students don't have any questions, and I have to leave to open my office hours in a few minutes. But what I didn't know that Poden and Evadne, the marine cladocerans, are predatory. What do they eat?
I didn't specifically say that they are predators. They are normally considered raptorial. In the old days, they were considered predatory because people didn't know anything about it. But nowadays, more informed people are calling them raptorial because they seem to be able to pick different types of food items. But certainly, some of them also are predatory. I mean, there are papers on them preying on rotifers and stuff. But sometimes it's just a large algae. But actually, all that is not really understood in detail yet. So we saw from our video observations that they do different things, and they also like to eat dead carcasses of their own species sometimes. So they like all kinds of things.
Okay, I said that was the last question, but I lied about that, because we have a question from Isabel in the chat room, who asks this: what do you think caves provide in terms of habitat that is advantageous to these species that wouldn't necessarily be found in other marine habitats?
Well, I guess it's not like, I mean, at the entrance they are choosing to go into caves. I guess it's just originally some early stocks of animals got stuck in caves, and they have that as an open area for diverging into and come up with all kinds of crazy life forms. So yeah, so what do they have? I mean, you could ask the same question for all kinds of habitats. It's just it's just the mystery of life that it penetrates into every possible space that is available, and caves happen to be one of them. And this was completely unknown until maybe 30 years ago, when, or maybe a little bit longer, when people started to discover that there are actually life that penetrate deeply down to the soil, ground water fauna and cave fauna. These things are related to each other, because what is the big difference between, in certain cases, groundwater and caves? It's really part of the same continuum. And I remember the senior colleague I have, Tom Eilif, who is a famous cave diver. He has been a part of the entire history exploring caves, and he had really difficulties in the beginning. He had been living, has been living on Bermuda for, I think, 16 years, and that's where he started to explore these caves, because he liked to dive. And then he just came across this diversity in those caves. He was a biologist, and he started to collect, and nobody really believed him. So that was a new thing 20, 25 years ago. One of the big sensations that we have this unknown type of life. Luckily enough, it seems that crustacea are very fond of caves, so I'm happy for that.
Okay, we've been going for an hour and a half. I think we should cut it off here. Jørgen, thank you very much for a spectacular talk. We really appreciate.
Thank you. It was a pleasure, and thank you for the fine questions. That was excellent.
Okay. Thank you very much. Goodbye, everybody.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye.